So good afternoon and welcome to Norwich University's 2020 Military Writers Symposium. This is our 26th year. Our focus this year is weaponizing water, ancient tactic, modern implications. We here at Norwich would like to welcome all of you to our state of Vermont, and our only regret is that you're not able to be with us here physically this year. If you've been with us throughout the entire day, welcome back. If this is the first time joining us, I'm just going to go through a little bit of where we've been and then some other features for the symposium. My name is Dr. Travis Morris. I am the executive director for the Military Writers Symposium. I am also have the honor and privilege of being the director for Norwich's Peace and War Center. The symposium this year is a joint initiative between the Center for Global Resilience and Security and the Patton Peace and War Center. We are thrilled that you're able to join us to focus on Norwich University's Environmental Security Initiative, and it's important to note that the symposium is part of that initiative. We're thrilled today to welcome Randy Brown, who's going to be speaking to us about how to publish, and he's affiliated with the Military Writers Guild, and so we're thrilled he's here, and we're going to have one of our top cadets introduce him here in a second. So Randy, welcome to Norwich University. So I want to highlight a few features. If you haven't seen the introduction video by President Anarumo, please do so. That is on our Military Writers Symposium webpage. That provides just some detail, context, and history about the symposium and situates what we're doing now in light of our past 25 years. So please take a minute to look at that, and that is on the schedule webpage. It's at the top. This is our inaugural year for the symposium in a virtual format. We are pleased to also present to you another inaugural event, and that is the connection between the symposium and Norwich Pro. You can earn a micro certificate in the Arctic Cold War this year if you are interested in following along the conversation after the symposium concludes tomorrow by getting a micro certificate in the Arctic Cold War. It's free this year, so check it out. It's also on the website, and you should be able to see that on the landing page. It's to the right. If you're not a Military Writers Symposium associate, please consider becoming one. There are no fees associated with this position or being an associate, just an expectation that you would partner with us to help us grow our beloved symposium into higher horizons. The newsletter and the chairman's message is also there. So just some format for today's presentation. We're following the same structure as before, but again, if you're joining us for the very first time, on your GoToWebinar control panel, you'll see there's a section that says questions. Anytime throughout the session, feel free to type any questions that you have for Randy. I will field those for him later on during the question and answer session. So it's my privilege to introduce Zach Jenkins. He's a cadet in charge of a battalion here at Norwich University. He's a Peace and War Center fellow. He's a communication major who happens to be the senior editor and leads Norwich's publication, which is the Guide On. He's the editor for that. So Zach, why don't you come on up and introduce Randy Brown. Thank you.
Sir, thank you very much. I'd just like to start out by saying it's an honor and a privilege to be able to introduce you, Mr. Brown. Thank you for being here. Randy Brown is a 20-year veteran of the United States Army with one overseas deployment during the Global War on Terror. In his 34-year civilian career, he has been a writer and editor at community and metro newspapers, as well as an editor of the national trade and consumer newsstand How-To magazines. He is now a freelance writer, editor, and independent book publisher based in Central Iowa. Brown offers an experienced and inclusive perspective on military writing, which he broadly defines as all writing that is focused on military, conflict, and national security themes or topics. In that definition, he includes literary, genre, scholarly, professional, journalistic, analytical, and other forms of writing. You need not have been a soldier, he writes, to write about war. Taxpayer, voter, or even just a citizen will suffice. Brown regularly works with military veterans and others to develop their own writing and publishing practices. Brown himself has demonstrated successes across a wide variety of storytelling and media forms. For example, in 2011, Brown embedded with his former Iowa National Guard unit as a civilian journalist in Afghanistan. He subsequently wrote award-winning 2015 poetry collection, Welcome to FOB Haiku, War Poems from Inside the Wire, and edited the 2016 nonfiction title, Reporting for Duty, U.S. Citizen Soldier Journalism from the Afghan Surge, 2010 to 2011. His essay, In the Valley of Lions, which regards the United States Department of State sponsored tourism conference in Pashmir Province, Afghanistan, was recently adapted for the nonfiction anthology, True War Stories, forthcoming in November 2020 from Z2 Comics. Brown was a finalist in the 2017 Counterinsurgency Lessons Learned Writing Contest administered by the Small Wars Journal for the article Telling the Brigade Story, a case study of United States Army policy, or I'm sorry, public affairs as an engine of operational effects, organizational history, and strategic narrative. In addition to traditional journalism, he has worked as a blogger for the AFWERX Las Vegas Innovation Center, a public-private technology accelerator sponsored by the United States Air Force. He has also written and designed multimedia instruction modules for the United States Army. Written under the pseudonym Charlie Sherpa, he regularly blogs about citizen soldier culture at redbullrising.com, about war poetry at fobhaiku.com, and about military writing at aimingcircle.com. Along with Steve Leonard, the creator of Doctrine Man, Brown co-edited the 2019 anthology Why We Write, Craft Essays on Writing War, a project conducted in partnership with the Military Writers Guild. Brown is a three-time poetry finalist in the Colonel Darren L. Wright Memorial Writing Awards administered by the Chicago-based literary journal Line of Advance. That work was recently collected in the Line of Advance anthology, Our Best War Stories, published this month. Brown has had poetry or essays appear in every annual issue of Proud to Be, Writing by American Warriors, published since 2012 by the Southeast Missouri State University Press. He has also served as a photography judge for that venue. Brown is the current poetry editor at the literary journal As You Were, published twice a year by the nonprofit Military Experience and the Arts. He is also the current member of the Military Reporters and Editors, the Military Writers Society of America, and is a board member for the nonprofit Military Writers Guild. In his talk today, titled Aiming to Publish, Military-Themed Writing Tips, Techniques, and Markets, Brown will share insights on how writers can generate and share their own military writing. Thank you very much, Mr. Brown.
Thank you, Cadet Jennings. Jenkins. That was awesome. I learned some things about myself I didn't even know. Thank you. Welcome everyone to a talk that is going to be far-flung and far-reaching, and I hope information, if not action-packed. Hopefully, you're coming to this discussion as somebody who is interested in not only writing about ideas and information within a military or conflict context, but also sharing those ideas and engaging in discourse with other writers, practitioners in the world. So welcome, and I look forward to our conversation. The first thing we need to do, of course, is admit to ourselves that military writing is a hard to define, fuzzy, and imperfect term. It is, but sometimes you just have to fight with the words that you got. Military writing, to many people, they think it sounds like it's just a bunch of officers or NCOs who are writing dry doctrine or operations orders. Steve Leonard, who is also the creator of the Doctrine Man cartoon, and I joke, it's not a perfect doctrinal term, but it's also not about writing doctrine. It's about other things. And while I am not here officially representing the Military Writers Guild, I do think that the definition that we're going to use today is completely in keeping with the Guild's current president, Christopher Ingram. His foreword in the anthology, Why We Write, Craft Essays on Writing War, pretty much includes any writing that is focused on themes or topics regarding or related to the military, war, or national security. We call ourselves military writing professionals. We call ourselves mill writers. We call ourselves military writers. Sometimes we call ourselves war writers. All of those things apply, but military writing is the term of art that we are choosing to use and move forward with in this conversation. Targets for today are going to be three. You can't hang out in the military without talking tactics, techniques, and procedures, or TTPs. We're going to change it up a little bit, and we're going to talk tips, techniques, and markets. Tips, we're going to talk very briefly about developing your writer's mindset, how to think about bringing writing into your professional life and maybe your personal life. I'm going to give you three quick techniques for ways that you can move your military writing career forward starting today. Little steps, little techniques that'll get you started. Any one of these, I could probably spend a half an hour to an hour on. We don't have that time, but I do want to give you a flavor of the types of things that the Military Writers Guild and others try to share as fellow writing professionals. And lastly, we're going to talk about markets, and we're going to define what a market is and hopefully expand your ideas about what the scope of military writing as defined by the Military Writers Guild can be. First off, your mindset as a writer. Number one, you are already a writer. Writers are leaders, and leaders are writers. You probably learned how to write a 5-paragraph essay in high school, and you're probably doing more of that in college. And if you're involved in ROTC, I know that you know that there are 6 paragraphs to the 5-paragraph operations order. And yes, the Army does the math that way. You cannot be a leader without being a writer. You're evaluated on written communications, and that will continue throughout your professional life. And that works even if you're not in uniform. That works if you're working in the Department of State or the Central Intelligence Agency or any number of other positions that are adjacent or focused on the type of topics that military writing is about. You also know that writing takes practice. You can't improve your marksmanship without throwing a lot of rounds downrange. Same way, you can't improve your writing in a particular area without cranking out a lot of words, and some of them may be garbage, and that's okay. You just come back and then you learn how to edit yourself and re-edit yourself and put it in front of others to be edited. And finally, when you have honed and crafted that piece, it is ready for publication. Writers get paid. Your writing is worth something. Now, payment doesn't necessarily mean that you get money for it. I will tell you that as a poet, I joke that I've finally found a career that pays less than newspaper journalism, and that is soldier poet. But as a poet, for many years, the most that I had ever been paid for a poem was a $25 gift certificate to a local barbecue restaurant. I will tell you that that was the best barbecue pork sandwich I have ever had, because it was compensation for a piece of published poetry. And that was my first monetary payment for that act. Again, your thoughts, your words, your ideas have worth. Make sure that you are getting something for it when you share it with others. Writers own what they write. I am not a lawyer. I know this only from practice, but at least under United States copyright law, as soon as you are done writing something or creating something, it does not have to be shared with anyone or locked away or registered somewhere. It is copyright to you. You own it. Other people have to have your permission to publish it elsewhere. So guard that carefully. Give people limited access to those rights. Because if you value your words, other people will value your words. If you don't value your words, they will be spent cheaply and ineffectively. Now, a couple of caveats, of course, in a military context. Number one, if you are writing with a security clearance in a protected position, you will want to have your work reviewed by the local JAG attorney or public affairs officer to make sure that you are not writing something that will get you into trouble or other people into trouble. That is part of the way you're doing business. Also, if you write something on duty or using U.S. government resources, you may not hold the copyright to it. The U.S. government actually has the rights to that. And that's why we can share ideas so easily and effectively in the military, because there are no copyright considerations in those regards. So that's why I joke, void where prohibited. But otherwise, if you are off duty and you are writing a science fiction story about something, don't worry, Uncle Sam should not have a concern there unless you are somehow talking about top secret stuff. Write only what you know is for suckers. And that's because the things that you heard in high school about you got to write what you know, that's a starting place. But you don't want to be limited to that. You want to be able to explore new ideas and make new connections with new people and explore new concepts like you're doing at this conference. So don't write only what you know. Find new things out. Write stuff that you don't know. At the same time, do not, please, be the young officer who starts off a paper saying, "In my vast years of experience," because that is an immediate credibility zapper. But also, don't be the colonel that says something silly like, "Well, you know, Iraq and Afghanistan, they're pretty much just the same problem," because that too is a credibility zapper. So write what you know, but be prudent. There's a list of Sherpatudes out there on the internet, things that Charlie Sherpa has said and codified into a list of rules for life and writing. And Sherpatude number three is, never speak with complete authority regarding that which you lack direct knowledge, observation, or suppressive fires. Next, I'm going to go into three quick tricks that can help you kind of move forward maybe 25 meters in your military writing career. Number one, you can craft a bio blurb. Now, I believe this is a term that is more widely used. It might also be called a short biography or a mini biography. But it is your personal elevator speech, the answer to the questions, who are you and what do you do? So if you are on an elevator with somebody and you have 20 seconds to introduce yourself and what you're all about, this is what you could say to them, and this is what you should put at the end of any material that you have published if you get the opportunity. They're typically written in third person, so you get to talk about yourself in that way. It's usually anywhere from 25, 50, 75 words. Take advantage of the space if the editor says 50 words. Don't just give them a one-line sentence that Randy Brown lives in Central Iowa. Give them something more to chew on. Always start off with your first and last name, and that's because oftentimes bio blurbs may not run immediately following the item in a publication, in a book or a magazine. sometimes they're collected at the end of that magazine or book. And alphabetizing by last name occurs, and it's easier for readers to find your listing if you have listed your name first. Make sure to mention your occupation and your brand. So if you are writing something as an armor officer or an armor NCO, make sure that you mention that you're a member of an armor unit, because that gives you potential credibility if you are writing about armor. Include at least one professional accomplishment. There will be something that you can claim that makes you a different Randy Brown than any other Randy Brown. So make sure that you put that into your copy so that other people can find you on a web search. Use personal details and use humor accordingly. Sherpitude number 26 is humor is a combat multiplier unless it isn't. So use it sparingly. Consider personal security or operational security when you are giving out details like Randy Brown lives with his spouse, two kids, three dogs in such and such Iowa. You might want to remove some of that personal detail for family considerations, or maybe just because it's not professionally relevant to what you're writing about. Here is the bio blurb that I use for my literary publications. Randy Brown embedded with this former Iowa Army National Guard unit. That tells you that I'm a veteran. That also tells you that I come from a citizen soldier perspective rather than a regular Army perspective. As a civilian journalist, okay, I'm a member of the media, at least in the civilian world. I authored a poetry collection. I'm sorry, he authored the poetry collection, Welcome to Fob Haiku, War Poems from Inside the Wire. His essays, journalism, and poetry have appeared widely both online and in print. That has given you, or the reader rather, two or three different ways that they could find Randy Brown on the internet. They could search for Welcome to Fob Haiku, they could search for poetry, they could search for journalism, and they could search on Amazon because it says in print. So online and in print tells you where I'm at. It explains a little bit as Charlie Sherpa, he writes about citizen soldier culture at RedBullRising.com, about more modern war poetry at FobHaiku.com. This sounds awfully familiar, Cadet Jenkins, I'm sorry. And about military writing at AimingCircle.com. It gives you three different places that you can find me. Right? Again, it gives the reader three different places that you can find Randy Brown. So that is a great example. I think it's been crafted and honed over many years. We could spend a half an hour about different ways to do these bio blurbs, but at least here's an example and a target to shoot at when you start working on your own stuff. Second thing I want to point out is writing a 300-word autobiography. Now, this goes back to military writers' mindset that writers are leaders and leaders are writers. You will never get away from writing because you will always have to do a biographical sketch. This is a document that you start and you maintain throughout your military career and in some agencies. If you are a foreign service officer for the Department of State, for example, you would be responsible for doing the same type of writing. This is an example from the newly emplaced Chief of Staff of the Air Force, General Brown, no relation, who, and this is his official biography on the U.S. Air Force website. It starts plain text about the place, what he is, who he is, where he's been, but it also then breaks down into bullet format, where was he schooled? Where was he promoted? Where did he serve? Where was he even published? What has he flown? How long has he flown it? What awards has he achieved? All of those things are a semi-official document that you will maintain throughout your professional career. And what I'm going to encourage you to do is start that right now and then begin to build onto it in a different way with personal details. Start including things like, when did you first join the military and why? Think about different experiences with the military that you might have had. And everybody has an experience with the military. And that goes back to Cadet Jenkins' introduction, where you can be a taxpayer and a voter and a citizen, and you still have an experience with the U.S. military. So think about those experiences and write them down. What did an uncle serve? Did a grandfather or a grandmother serve? Were you inspired to serve by a particular movie or a news event? Start writing those nuggets down and put them in the context of your biography. And over time, you will develop a 1 or 2 page document that you can go back to at any time that you are feeling like you don't have anything to write about. And you can begin to tease out little details like your proudest day in uniform, your most unproud day in uniform, the funniest thing that you've ever seen in the military. Those details can become essays. They can become examples in op-ed pieces or blog posts. And they can even become poems if you don't know what you're doing. So definitely try starting your 300-word autobiography. Now, I just talked about generating work from a document. Writers love to talk about prompts. Prompts are little tricks and techniques that we use to kind of get ourselves writing. And here's one that I developed off of a 2012 movie called Memorial Day. Normally, I play the trailer, the video from YouTube. I'm just going to read the copy today. Memorial Day, by the way, tells the story of two veterans, one grandfather who fought in World War II, and one young man who grows up to serve in Iraq in the in my favorite and beloved 34th Infantry Division, Red Bull. And uses the premise that the young man has found a footlocker in an attic and starts asking his grandfather questions about military service that his grandfather is somewhat unprepared to deal with. The movie was originally entitled Souvenirs, so I call this the Souvenirs prompt. And the trailer voiceover goes something like this. I didn't loot, and I didn't steal. I collected things that would help me remember. What I didn't count on was, they don't let you forget. You found the footlocker, Kylie, so I'll make a deal with you. Pick any three, and I'll tell you the story behind each one. God willing, you won't have to experience any of those things yourself. But if you do, you'll be ready. So to use this prompt, if we were in a workshop setting, I might read that or have you watch the video. And then we might spend 10 minutes kind of free writing about objects that we remember from our experiences with the military. And maybe you might write about your dog tags, or maybe you might write about a belt buckle or a pair of boots or a helmet or your flak jacket, or maybe something that, a Humvee or an MRAP truck that you particularly remember. But objects that explore the object in ways that they smell, they taste, they feel, the circumstances around which you remember them, those types of things then can generate new thoughts, new writing, new ideas. So souvenirs, a writing prompt. Now, I will admit I'm old school, so I learned it Akoka. You probably, if you're in ROTC, learned it OACOKE, but for me, Akoka, the acronym stood for Observations in Fields of Fire, Cover and Concealment, Obstacles, Key Terrain, and Avenues of Approach. And hopefully those haven't changed, even though the acronym has. So what we're going to talk about today is markets, which is kind of terrain analysis for military writers. So Sherpa, what's a market? A market is any venue that you can sell or to which you can submit your work for publication. It can be magazines, websites. I will count contests as a market, journals, anything that will share your work with podcasts, radio programs, theatrical productions, any of those would be a market. Now, there are whole telephone books full of ideas on how and where you should send your stuff to be published. The biggest one at the library or at the bookstore is probably called Writer's Market. Very imaginative title. And the publishers of these documents will break them out and into other forms. Like there is one for long fiction and short fiction. And there's probably one for science fiction and romance fiction. There's certainly one for poets. And if you're going to start submitting manuscripts to traditional publishers, there's even a guide to literary agents. So the writer's market publishers definitely are out there. There are resources that you should investigate at the library at your local bookseller. I've even found ones that are for specific national markets, like there's this one for the Canadian marketplace. I believe there's one for the Australian marketplace. And there's one for Christian writers, which is its own. You can imagine that Christian writers might have its own set of romance writing and mystery writing and whatnot. So definitely look for those resources. The problem for mill writers, there is no resource like that. Maybe that's because military writing is a fuzzy term, hard to define term. That's probably the case because you can write military thrillers, you can write military romance, you can write military nonfiction, but the reading public doesn't necessarily consider all of those as military. They consider themselves instead mysteries and romances and whatnot. So the device at the lower right hand of your screen is an aiming circle. It is a device used for laying in the guns and for directing your fire from mortars and artillery pieces. One thing that we are trying to do at the aimingcircle.com community of practice is create a taxonomy of military writing friendly markets. And those include literary markets, what we are calling professional markets, ones that are related to either officially or unofficially to professional military education, the classes that you need or the coursework that you need to advance in your military careers. Journalistic markets, scholarly markets or academic markets, what we're calling opinion or op-ed, and I'll define that term later, and consumer markets. So right now, the taxonomy, and it keeps changing on us, but right now we're trying to limit our selections to six different ways to think about military writing. This author is Mary Robinette Kowal. She is a science fiction writer. She's also the host of a rather great podcast. It's only 15 minutes long each week called Writing Excuses. I encourage you to check that out. She says that the way to assess any market are three things: audience, pay rate, and shininess. audience is pretty straightforward. How many people are going to see this thing? So if you get published in Acme Magazine and Acme Magazine has a circulation of 3,000 readers, you can say that you've gotten in front of 3,000 sets of eyeballs. Pay rate, she says, is exactly what it sounds like. Are you being paid adequately for your effort? Now, for that poem that I was talking about, a $25 gift certificate to a barbecue shack, that was more than adequate for me for that poem. If I want to be, if it were a book or a longer piece, I'm not so sure that that $25 sandwich would have necessarily been adequate compensation rather. So you can judge a market by audience and pay rate. Those are pretty straightforward things. The next thing is kind of personal. Shininess is, how much do you want to be in this particular market? And she says, I grew up reading the magazine of fantasy and science fiction. So getting into that particular magazine was, as she says, shiny to her. So I've got a poet veteran buddy of mine who really would like to see one of his poems in the New Yorker. And so he sends off his very best work to the New Yorker first and waits 6 to 12 months to hear whether or not they're going to print his poem. That's, the New Yorker is shiny to him. It doesn't matter necessarily about the audience or the pay rate. He is motivated by the fact that he could get into the New York Yorker magazine. So if you always wanted to have your byline in the New York Times or Popular Mechanics magazine, all those are good goals. So decide what's shiny for you and what counts as motivation for you. Tip from Sherpa, look for professional copyrights language. Look for an explicit discussion about what rights a publication wants to get from you. Are they looking for permission only to print your work one time and maybe to put it into a print anthology? Or are they looking for permission to print your work at any time, at any place, in any technology, using any technology that they can think of? I would suggest to you that you would want to go with the first publication and not the second publication. You want to limit your sale of rights as much as you can so that you have the opportunity to sell the work to other markets. And again, I apologize, that's a larger conversation, but I at least want to put it on your radar screens. Also, a Sherpa note, I try to avoid markets that seem to stereotype military personnel or veterans in particular ways. I am not a special operator. I'm not a Navy SEAL. I'm not an Army Ranger. I don't necessarily submit my work to any place that celebrates that veteran's identity and only that veteran's identity. Like, there are many of us. We are soldiers, sailors, Marines, Coast Guardsmen and women. We contain multitudes, and we need to tell the veteran's story as varied as reality is. I say avoid being stereotyped, because I also am a bit suspicious of any well-meaning effort to provide therapy or therapeutic benefit or healing through writing. I am not about therapeutic writing. I'm not about expressive writing. I and my fellow practitioners are trying to write for merit, writing to achieve good writing. Yeah, it can be useful every once in a while to work out some emotions, but that is not what we're about. So when you have well-meaning programs come along and say that all veterans are broken and they need healing and we can provide healing through the practice of writing, that's not my particular interest. And so be aware of language such as that as you are engaging the marketplace. Literary markets. Literary markets are those that, it's pretty straightforward. They feature fiction, nonfiction, essays, poetry, dramatic writing, you name it. Unfortunately, they're not usually paying markets. There are some that pay. They might pay $10 a poem. They might pay $100 a poem or essay, but those are fewer and further between. A phrase that trips a lot of military writers up is simultaneous submissions. You're looking for language along with copyrights language in a call for submissions that says simultaneous submissions are accepted or not accepted. Simultaneous submissions only means that you can send one magazine the same thing that you're sending another. So if the editor says simultaneous submissions are not acceptable, that means that that editor would like to be the only publication to which that particular item has been submitted at any given time. Top military literary markets, because this often is a question that comes up in Q&A. Number one, right, these are all pretty equal. The Jeff Charlotte Memorial Award is probably in its fifth iteration right now. It comes up every other year. They've selected the 2019 winners, and they will be running them in the spring issue, I believe, of the Iowa Review. So keep your eyes out for the Jeff Charlotte Memorial Award, because it is top shelf prose, poetry, fiction and nonfiction, memoir and poetry. I'm a little biased here because I'm a three-time finalist with the Colonel Darren L. Wright Awards by the Literary Journal Line of Advance. They are just coming out with their first print anthology of 5 years of award-winning prose and poetry. I think it publishes next week. Also this year, they announced that they were opening to military family members as well. So there are separate categories for prose and poetry with military family members. So if that applies to you or somebody you know, definitely get the word out. Cash prizes in both the Charlotte and the Wright Awards. All you have to do is have one award-winning poem, and you may have made more money on that one poem than you could with an entire book of poetry. There's also the Proud to Be series. It has run since 2012. I am proud to say that I am in the first 8 volumes. However, the one coming out later this month, I am not in. All of these are highly competitive literary markets. If you get a piece selected by one of them, you have achieved something. I really, you can't write what you don't read. So make sure to seek things like this out and read what is considered prize winning. And that will be a good way to channel your efforts. On a different note, Military Experience in the Arts Online Journal, As You Were, has a different publishing model. I am the poetry editor currently. We work with fiction writers, nonfiction writers, and poets who have been published hundreds of times and who may never have been published. And if you're just starting out, if you have a piece that's 80% there, 90% there, and just needs a little bit more work, we will actually workshop with you, unlike I think any other publication that I'm aware of, to help get it the rest of the way. So definitely keep us in mind. Submissions windows typically come up once or twice a year, and a new issue is coming out November. Okay, professional markets, and I'll try to pick it up here. Professional markets are centered on communities of practice. What are communities of practice? Simple, they are communities of people who are all doing similar jobs and functions. So if you're in the military, you are in a military community of practice. If you're in the Signal Corps, you are in a community of practice with fellow military communicators. If you're in the British Army or Air Force, you're in your own community of practice. We each are members of different communities, but this is a way to think about what separates us from people who are just merely enthusiasts or hobbyists. That would be a community of interest. I say official in both unofficial venues because there are unofficial blogs that support professional military education, which are great places to get published, particularly when you're starting out. They can seek news and historical analyses and book reviews. They often are centered in associations like the Association of the United States Army, the National Guard Association of the United States, Military Officers Association of America. They could be centered in branches. So the Army has Military Review Magazine out of Fort Leavenworth. The Marine Corps Gazette, I think, is the Association of the Marine Corps. I forget where they're based. But if you're in a particular branch, your branch will have places to write professionally at all levels. I jokingly call these think tanks. They're not necessarily pure think tanks, but places like the Atlantic Council and the Center for International Maritime Security, CIMSEC, United States Naval Institute, Training and Doctrine Command in the Army, their Mad Scientist Initiative, all of those places, they run blogs, they run contests, they run platforms, they run fora that you can get published in and start working on your writing chops. Writing takes practice. Journalistic markets usually focus on first and third person reports of experience. They're usually pitched or queried before you start writing and reporting. So you send a letter to the editor saying, hey, would you like to see a 5,000 word article on such and such topic? And they send you a, yeah, we'll pay for that. No, we won't pay for that. If they won't pay for that, you move on to the next thing or the next publication. But pitching or querying is something that you do in journalism a lot of times, rather than writing on spec or on speculation. However, there are times when something, for example, is particularly timely. If you're writing a news report of something that happened yesterday, and in order to be worthwhile, it needs to run somewhere today, you can submit an entire work to an editor and say, hey, would you pay me for this? Scholarly or academic markets usually feature longer and researched articles. They're usually peer-reviewed, which means they go out to one or two or more fellow practitioners who know just as much about a topic as you might. It is a lengthier editorial process. It can take months or even years to successfully bring a scholarly article to publication. The emphasis is on really deep original research and interpretation. Those journals may also take smaller items like book reviews, literature reviews, and smaller articles. Examples of scholarly markets, just off the top of my head, would be the Journal of Military History would be one. Journal of Veteran Studies would be one that I read an awful lot. War Literature and the Arts is a 30-year-old hybrid of a literary and scholarly publication out of the U.S. Air Force Academy's Department of English. The WLA journal, War, Literature, and the Arts, definitely check it out. It's great writing. It can take a long time to get in. And also, let's not forget Norwich University's own Journal of Peace and War Studies would be a great example of a scholarly market. Opinion and op-ed markets. Think of these as like places for blog posts, short essays of 500 to 750 words. Op-ed is an old newspaper term. It means opposite the editorial page. It does not mean an opinion editorial. John Spencer, Military Writers Guild member in Why We Write, has a great short two or three page essay about how he learned that term and how he learned to craft an essay that uses a little bit of personal experience and a little bit of news headlines, and you put those two together and you can create some coverage that really goes viral on the internet. Blogs are a great place for these. Letters to the editor, they are not dead. Look in association magazines at the front of the book, and you'll find, or at the front of the magazine, and you'll see places where people have written in to the editor. Guest columns, typically one page in a in a magazine is about 750 words. So that gives you a target to aim for. Finally, consumer markets. And I come from a background of newsstand magazine sales. So these are typically paying platforms, at least they were back in the day when people were buying magazines and buying advertising in them. But they typically serve communities of interest. And remember what the distinction I made between community of practice as a community of practitioners. Community of interest would just be people who are interested in a topic. So a good example of this is Military History Monthly, Military Heritage Magazine, Military History Quarterly. See a theme here. But they can also narrow down to people who are just interested in one particular historical moment, or maybe even one particular type of warfare in a particular historical moment. I'm going to have to check out Civil War Navy because that just sounds awesome. Smithsonian's Air and Space Museum is a great special interest magazine. It deals with all forms of aviation, aviation history, aviation technology, combat aircraft, obviously. It's a little bit more narrowed down. It's going to be talking only about the military stuff. One favorite of mine, Strategy and Tactics Magazine, is a war gaming magazine. Now, this is where the magic happens, and it's easy to see with this lineup in front of us. You see Korean War paratroopers on the cover of Strategy and Tactics. If you developed an interest in the Korean War and air operations in the Korean War, maybe you could review that game that is included in that magazine. Maybe that would cause you to ask, well, when were there other paratroop operations? Maybe were there any in the Vietnam War? Maybe I could pitch a story to Vietnam Magazine about Vietnam air ops. Maybe I could write something for Air and Space Magazine or Combat Aircraft about the same topic. You can develop a little mini expertise in something and have a research folder full of stuff that you can. You don't sell the same story to different markets or different publications, rather, but you do have the ability to write a first-person essay about one thing, write a personality profile about a famous Korean War veteran or general in another. You can write about the technology behind airborne operations. All of those things might come from the same research folder. Another place where the magic can happen is when you have developed an expertise in professional writing, or a comfort in an expertise in scholarly writing or professional writing or journalism or what have you, and you start practicing your craft outside of that comfort zone. I was a journalist for 20 or 30 years before I rediscovered poetry. I was embedded in a unit in Afghanistan for a couple of weeks. I encountered this scene at Combat Outpost Najil in Nangarhar Province. Relevant to today's conference subject, note the cascade of plastic water bottles that have been cast off by the Afghan soldiers from this small little rustic outpost across the valley from the American troops. If you will give me a moment, I'd like to share with you a poem that I wrote called The Bottle Fall at Cobb Najil. In summer sun, a plastic waterfall cascades, the empty residue of our Afghan brothers encamped along the ridge just across from the fortress we call the Death Star. Above and below, a scout weapons team buzzes up and down the valley, TIE fighters searching for a truck full of fertilizer, a bomb waiting for us to happen. We have taught the Afghans well, that water comes only in bottles, that cowboys don't care for the desert, that our brand of war is sustainable. Thanks for letting me share that. Again, I think that's I offer that as an example of you can develop an expertise in one type and a comfort in one type of writing. And when you're comfortable with that, write what you don't know, move out into other things, take names. We've covered today tips and techniques and markets. I'd look forward to your questions about military journalism and lessons learned about editing or writing essays, about how to write and what it took to corral more than 60 authors, novelists, journalists, diplomats, think tankers, soldiers, sailors, a lot of aviators for the Why We Write project with the Military Writers Guild, about poetry and prose, and even adapting an essay that I wrote about going to Pangaea for a graphic novel that's coming out next month that is all nonfiction comics. I kid you not. And it's a very interesting experience to see yourself rendered as a cartoon character. I should have taken Dr. Mann's word for it. Thank you. That concludes my remarks. I look forward to your questions.
Randy, thank you very much. Just like you mentioned in your conclusion, you've covered a lot of practical details. You've given a lot of information from those that are just starting out their writing career, that are students here at Norwich University, to those that maybe have had time on the battlefield, and those that have spent some time in service and are currently engaged in their professional soldier, sailor, marine career. So like I said, we have about 3 minutes left. So I'm just going to come to a really important question here.
Certainly.
Rejection. How do authors deal with rejection? How should they deal with rejection? And what's your experience? Particularly, we're asking this question because this could be the end of someone's writing career if they don't handle it a certain way. So just your thoughts on that in a really condensed fashion, please. Thank you.
Well, you know, like Gunny said, adapt, improvise, overcome. You know, it is a mindset thing. You need to believe in yourself as a writer. I've got pieces that have been rejected many, many, many times, and I'm convinced that they are still good pieces of writing, and I just haven't found a home for them. So when I get a rejection, whether it's a piece of nonfiction or a poem, I have a list, and I have the top three targets that I want that piece to go to. And after I get a rejection from number one, I send it to number two. And after I get a rejection from number two, I get it back from number three. At number three, if I get rejected, I look at the piece again, because it's now been, you know, 6 months, 12 months. And I look at that piece really hard and say, okay, do I still believe in this piece? And if the answer is yes, then I come up with another three publications to which to submit, and I send them along one by one. You just got to keep plugging away, because you miss 100% of the shots you don't take.
Thank you very much. And in one of our previous conversations, we were talking about your career and particularly being a poet. And this presentation is going to be followed up at 6 o'clock by a Schultz fellow. And wanted to just mention that our first Schultz fellow happened to contribute poetry to the symposium.
And outstanding.
That it was one of the most powerful things that happened over the course of the symposium, because as the student read it to an audience of hundreds, it injected a sense of emotion, just like the poetry that you just read. It added an entire other dimension. And so I just wanted to publicly thank you in front of everyone that's joining us today, that there are multiple different dimensions of military writing, and being exposed to all genres is absolutely incredibly important. So on that note, I just wanted to also thank you, Randy. You gave us a lot of material that could be a week-long seminar workshop, and it's important just to have a survey over and an overview, and that's what you've done for us and for those that are attending, and so we appreciate that. and also just appreciate the fact that there aren't many of you that have served as a journalist in the military and can share that experience, and that have also been so prolific just in terms of some of your writing. And so we're thrilled to have you part of the symposium this year. You added another dimension, and that dimension is the craft of writing. And that's something that we definitely wanted to address. So Excellent. Thank you, sir, once again. So for everyone else, we have one more session today, and this will be one of our own. It's a cadet who was named the Richard Schultz Fellow for the Military Writers Symposium, and she's going to be giving a presentation about maritime water as it relates to Africa, specifically Tanzania. I wanted to also just remind everyone that the main event tomorrow is the panel, which will go live at noon, and all the sessions that you saw today, including Randy's, will be available to review tomorrow via video. And so if you missed one, or you wanted to hear something else, or you wanted to hear Randy talk about more in detail, then you'll be able to see that tomorrow from onwards as well. So again, Randy, thank you so much. Thank you so much for everyone that's attended. And we look forward to seeing some of you back here at 6 p.m. Randy, all the best to you, sir.
Outstanding.
Okay, bye-bye.